We should talk about the reason the museum is here to begin with, based on the history of the man whose name is outside the door, Abraham Belsky. The work that you see behind us and some of the other work is his work. And this museum was built by the Lions Club. And there's someone here who has a lot more history and knowledge and talent about the museum than I, and that's John Murphy. So, Murph, why don't you just take it from here?
When Mr. Belsky passed away, the family, they were his children, were interested mostly in selling the property and going somewhere else. And the contractor that bought the house was going to tear it down. And when he looked inside, he discovered what you're seeing here. And he just couldn't do it. So he went to a man by the name of Jerry Kreitenstein, who was the town attorney and judge, and a lion. And they went and they looked at it and they agreed that they just couldn't throw this away. So the Lions Club got involved, they packed it all up, put it in storage. And at that time, the Lions Club in town here were mostly contractors. And they actually built the place. It wasn't just something they funded. They hired an architect to do a museum design. And then they actually built it. They dug the foundations, poured the footings, did the carpentry, the electrical work, the whole nine yards to get it going. And then since then, they've staffed it. There's at least three or four Lions involved on the board of directors and involved with the town and on behalf of the Belsky. So we still to this day are finding parts and pieces of his material. It's just incredible. I don't think the man ever really slept. He worked right up until the very days before he passed away. In fact, one of the last things he did is just over here a bit. I don't know if you can see it. It's not only the Vietnam veteran. We've had men from who served in Vietnam come in here and tell us that is absolutely accurate. And that is typical of Belsky. Whatever he did, it's accurate, it's true, it's real. And whether it was the small sculptures of children, anatomical, whatever. And he worked for many, many years with Dr. Fairley of Fairley Dickinson fame. And then eventually, as Fairley passed away, he became involved more with coinage and metallic arts, let's put it that way. And he became quite proficient, quite famous for doing those. He was an amazing, versatile man.
Well, what happened was afterward, they opened the museum with the Lions Club, having beautifully built it, we put up his show. After a while, it was needed to have some more excitement in it. So then we decided to make it into a gallery of artists in the Northern Valley. And that's how what you see in this particular showing of the Best of the Belsky has been done in the last 8 years by these artists. So it's really, as I've said before, and as Murph and myself and about four or five other volunteers have a love for the cultural scene. And that's what this gallery and museum is now about, in honor of the man named Belsky. The reason I got involved with the Belsky as a curator, it's in my hometown, and there's a bunch of us volunteers, probably all of us retired, we have a love for the arts, and also a love to bring some culture to the Northern Valley. And we've been putting on these shows every month, and every month we've been getting different artists, we screen them, and every month the show's been getting better and better. As you can see by some of the work that's in this film, it's a variety of talents, in all kinds of mediums. My medium at the moment is pen and ink, and I've had a love for the American Indian for years. And every time I go out west, I shoot pictures of them, I do my research, and here I have a series of, as I call them, Tenable Indians. They're all American Indian chiefs that have, over the years have had some historical value. So I've done these, I've also donated them to the museum's library as well as the American Indian Museum. And I do other pen and ink work, but I've had a great fondness and a love for the American Indian, as much as I have a love for the Belsky Museum.
I can't remember how I did get involved with the Belsky, but since I live less than a block away, I suppose. One day I was up here just by chance to look at the paintings in another exhibit or something, and I got talking to someone. They said, well, what do you do? And I said, well, I'm a ship modeler, and then we got to talking. I can't tell why I'm interested in ships. My memory is that my grandfather took me down to look at them during the Second World War. I can't recall missing my father or anything like that. He was in the service in the last part of the war. But we lived in Duluth, Minnesota, which is a long, long ways from salt water. But the ships that would come in and out are full oceanside ships. And there was a place where we could stand, and the ships would come right by us, and I mean right by us, within 50 feet or so. So here's these mammoth things, 700 feet long, that you have to look at to watch go by, and you're like this. And there are people up there, and there's a little guy steering the thing. It just was a tremendous influence in my head.
Well, I'm very impressed with, you know, what I've seen here today. The quality of the work is outstanding. I was flattered, really, when Gary asked me to be part of it, because, I mean, I do this for fun. It's been a hobby since I was 6 years old. I'm now 48, and graying by the minute. So I've been doing this for a long time, but it's always just been fun for me. It's a diversion, it's stress relief. It just keeps me, you know, I said to my wife, you know, keeps me off the streets at night, keeps me entertained, and so I do it for fun. I don't take it very seriously, but some of the stuff up there is just, especially the crazy stuff that Ozzy does with all the turrets that rise and fall together. It's just, you know, sometimes I think some people have a sickness for this hobby. It's not a, it's more than just a hobby, it's an obsession.
As you see, when I push this button here, it's like this, okay? But now, this is what holds it, and this is what the motor turns it. And what you see here, all the things what you see in here, it's all down here, like this here. And then you've got this here, like this here. And that's what I made it, so people got an idea what it looks like, you know? And certainly, but like this, as you see, one reverse it, and I use gears from the clocks. And then I have to line this one up like this, and then again.
I fell into hand-woven tapestry somewhat by accident on a trip to Ireland. I found a place where they were teaching hand-woven tapestry, and I was intrigued, so I went back the following year and took their course. And within a couple of hours of the first day at the course, I knew I had found a medium that not only I could do at, but I could do well, and that I could really excel at and express myself. So I have two pieces here. One is the hand-woven tapestry that's called Waiting. And it's a very stylized figure sitting with her back to the audience at side of a counter or a table. And we don't really know what she's waiting for. She's just sort of suspended in space waiting. The other piece, the sculptural piece, I did about 2 years ago, and it's called Keeping Body and Soul Together. At first glance, it looks a bit like a peapod. It's a vessel form, and it does have rounded shapes in it. So of course, on the surface, it does look like a peapod. But it's the inner and outer self. And the lacing through it is simply an idea of keeping body and soul together, keeping the self together against the vagaries of life.
Somebody said to me, when you carve a stone, you have something as a soul. And I started carving stone about 40 years ago and haven't left it, and I loved every minute of it. What I have here at Belsky are two stones. One is called Forest Portals. There are two stones, and you can sort of see through stones. And I always like to see through things. I don't want them met with a wall. And I think it has a powerful stance. And as you will see when you see the pieces, there are abstractions. Because, like Mr. Belsky, who was interested in detail representation of true things, I am interested in what drives you, what is making you get up in the morning and do things.
just a way of focusing the research, putting the research to work, and not surprising to me, considering my ego, getting some attaboys along the way.